Good to see everybody here. Got a beautiful day out there, so it's nice to see it. We want to let everyone know, Brother Charles and Sister Rachel, the baby was born Wednesday. And so little William Gregory is the new addition to the church. 8 pounds, 5 ounces. So it's a, yeah. I'm sure it's a blessing to him. So let's remember Sister Linda. She's in the hospital at Floyd. Her oxygen was extremely low, and they've got it back up, but they've requested that she don't have any visitors right now because she keeps wanting to take the oxygen off, and right now she needs every bit that she can. So let's continue to remember her in prayer that she'll get better and be able to get out there, out of there. And let's remember those that are traveling over in South Africa. Atlanta canceled flights, I believe, so they were supposed to have left Friday and didn't get to leave out until yesterday. And then still had a pretty long layover in Atlanta, again, had to wait for quite a bit. So they're going to be really tired by the time they get there. But let's remember them, that they'll have good travel the rest of the way and be feeling really good when they get there. I know Brother and Sister Ram and the family are going to really appreciate the fellowship to get to see them and stuff. And so would there be any other need this morning? Yes, sir. Who? Charlene Robert, yes. Brother and Sister James, yes. Okay, let's remember the sister here. Yep. Yes, their brother passed away, or, yeah. Yeah, okay, let's remember them. Yeah, there was one back here, Brother Bill. Okay, let's remember Brother Bill's mom, Sister Joan. Okay, let's remember Sister Joan too, yes, yes. Okay, let's remember that brother. Anyone else? Yes. Okay, Sister Audrey. Anyone else? All right, any unspoken requests in? All right. Brother Turner, would you care to come up and lead us in prayer? And if you feel like singing a song, just go right ahead.
I'd like to greet everyone on this crisp morning and say it's good to be in the house of worship.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Father, this morning, again, we come before your throne of grace and mercy, realizing, O Lord, that we're a most blessed people. We thank you so much for the privileges and the opportunity that you give us day by day, and for your watch, care, and protection and provision. We thank you, dear God, for the way that you minister to these that are less than their best in health and other circumstances, Lord, that they're dealing with. We pray especially, O Lord, for Sister Linda and for Brother and Sister James and Sister Sandy and Brother George that's having surgery tomorrow. Dear God, for all the others that are needing thy touch, we just pray that thou shalt stretch forth your hand of mercy and grace once again for each one. Yea, Lord, according to your will and purpose for each life, O Lord, we just ask that which we desire to see you do, dear God, and know that you must work according to your plan and purpose in every situation. We look to you for your precious anointing as we come together this morning. Dear God, in the song service, in any testimony or whatever it is, let it be for thy glory and honor and praise. Ask you to bless Brother David as he leads us singing, and Brother Allen as he brings a message to us this morning, O God. May you be glorified in all, and may you, O Lord, help us to be conscious of what's going on round about us and to walk wisely in the midst of this crazy public that we're having to mix in with. Dear Lord, we pray for Israel this morning, knowing, O Lord, that the time is short for that which we're expecting, but we look to you for all things and know that you'll work everything out according to your plan and purpose, and we give thanks and praise unto thy great name. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Glory to God. The Lord said, let the weak say I'm strong. Yet in my heart I felt that this was wrong. Till I saw a little lily pushing up a heavy cloth, and I marveled at the wisdom of my God. Oh, I marvel at the wisdom of my God. Yes, I marvel at the wisdom of my God. When I see a little lily pushing up a heavy clod, and I marvel at the wisdom of my God. When they sealed the tomb, they thought that they had won. But like that little lily, he rolled back the stony clod, and they marveled at the wisdom of my God. Oh, I marvel at the wisdom of my God. Yes, I marvel at the wisdom of my God. When I see a little lily pushing up a heavy clod, and I marvel at the wisdom of my God. Our King Jesus has established him a throne. He has come with it and claimed me as his own. He has bought me with his blood, I'm his alone. And I marvel at the love to me he's shown. Oh, I marvel at the wisdom of my God. Yes, I marvel at the wisdom of my God. When I see a little lily pushing up a heavy cloth, and I marvel at the wisdom of my God.
Well, some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. If I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Now when the shadows of this life have gone, I'll fly away. Oh, like a bird from prison bars have flown, I'll fly away. Fly away. Well, now if I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Now just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away. Oh, now to that land where joy shall never end, I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. Well, now if I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. Well, now if I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Oh, unto the uttermost, he's so unjust.
wonderful and glorious. Oh, what a Savior is mine. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior.
Sister Lori, would you all have a song this morning? And then after that, maybe Sister Drusy, would you have one after that? Then?
I was in sin's prison, oh, so dark and cold. Just a lost sheep wandering from God's eternal fold. Then the gate swung open, Jesus spoke to me. I have signed your pardon. May now go free. Jesus signed my pardon. This I surely know. He took my place at Calvary. Now I won't have to go. All my life I'll give to him. He gave his for me. There at Calvary. Now my life's worth living since I've been set free. I'm so glad he was willing to save a wretch like me. Now I have a promise, not a prison cell. Jesus signed my pardon. Oh yes, he paid it all. Jesus signed my pardon. This I surely know. He took my place at Calvary. Now I won't have to go. All my life I'll give to him. He gave his for me. When he signed my pardon there at Calvary. Now my life's worth living since I've been set free. I'm so glad he was willing. Save a wretch like me. Now I have a promise, not a prison cell. Jesus signed my pardon, oh yes, he paid it all. Jesus signed my pardon, this I surely know. He took my place at Calvary.
All right, Sister Drucy, and with the sisters from down in Kentucky, have a song.
Testimony. I had quite a scare Wednesday. I walked out about 1:45 to get my mail, and I didn't take my cane with me. I have a big heavy wooden cane that I usually took for protection for the bad dogs next door. And I didn't take it. But when I got out and got my mail and looked right at the other edge of my property, there was a man laying out there, just sprawled out at the edge of the road. And I stood there a few minutes and watched him. He never moved or anything. And there's so much stuff goes on next door that I wouldn't walk over there to him. I stood there and watched for a while, and he didn't move with all the traffic. So I went to the house and called 911. And they told me to stay in the house and lock my doors. And here come fire rescue and police cars and everything. Sirens going. He never moved. And they got out of the vehicles and walked over to him. And they finally got him setting up. And I just watched them, and they walked next door and talking to the woman over there. So finally, after a while, I walked out there at the other side and talking to the policeman. And it was a man from next door. They had kicked him out but wouldn't let him have his stuff, and he was just hanging out there. But I said, with so much drugs and drunkenness and everything, I wouldn't even walk over there where he was at. And I told the policeman, I said, well, I kind of feel bad that I called. Nothing wrong with him. He said, oh, no, ma'am. You always call. That's what we're here for. I just thank the Lord for his protection.
Thank you for that testimony, sister. It truly is a terrible place sometimes with the people in this world. You don't know what to expect anymore. All right, were the sisters in from down there? And then Brother Dwayne, would you have one after that then?
With hopes and dreams completely crumbled, my life was built on sinking sand, bowed beneath the weight of sorrow, till I was touched. Oh,
For that. All right, Brother Dwayne, and then the gospel ears after that. Then.
Good to be here. This is like heaven. We find many people who can't understand why we are so happy and free. We've crossed over Jordan to Canaan's fair land, and this is like heaven to me. Oh, this is like heaven to me, praise God. Oh, this is like heaven to me. I've crossed over Jordan to Canaan's fair land, and this is like heaven. When I get happy, I sing and I shout. The devil don't like it, you see. When we're filled with the Spirit, there is a legend, and that's what's the matter with me. Oh, this is like heaven to me, praise God. Oh, this is like heaven to me. I've crossed over Jordan to Canaan. Heard the sweet music from heavenly shores, land over the sea. A soul-stirring message from Jesus our Lord, and this is like heaven to me. Oh, this is like heaven to me, praise God. Heard the sweet music from heavenly court, from glory land over the sea. It was a soul-stirring message from Jesus our Lord, and this is like heaven to me. Oh, this is like heaven to me, praise God. Oh, this is like heaven. I've crossed over Jordan. And then Brother Kevin, would you and Sister Sandy have one after that?
God's people today are gathering to watch for His appearing. The church is getting ready for that final journey home. Each one's made preparation. They've met the Lord at Calvary. Their sins are washed as white as snow beneath the crimson flow. And now there's no condemnation. Jesus is almost here. The saved will soon be leaving, and I know I'm in that number. The Savior's blood has cleansed me. Thank God he saves by grace. And now there's no
Sandy, Brother Kevin.
Never get tired of thinking about the Lord. And I was sitting there and they sang that first song, well, not the first one, but the ones from Kentucky sang that song, the one that holds the scar. It's so beautiful. And I thought, when he's done everything, and I thought about the unity through the convention and the ministry. And a lightning bolt just hit me, and it was like, when the people get in unity, when there's no more gossiping, when there's no more storytelling, and we all get in one accord, and we come in here for one purpose, to talk to the Lord, to meet together, to have communion one with another in our spirit. It just thrilled me, and I started to tear up, and joy filled my heart. So I just praise him.
It's my desire to live for Jesus. It's my desire to live for Him. Often I
Stand and thank everyone for their songs and testimonies this morning. We'll get ready to turn it over to the brother Alan. It was really hard to see the convention end this year. There was just such a sweet spirit, and everyone was just so peaceful, and you just really felt that love. It was hard to see everyone leave, but we thank the Lord that we hopefully don't have much longer on this earth to have to live here. So, all right, we'll turn it over.
Well, praise the Lord this morning. Good to see each one of you out. Appreciate every one of you, and the ones that are away from here that went back home few days ago, and others that didn't get to make it. We thank the Lord for you and appreciate each one of you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we're grateful to you for this morning that you've given us, and for, Lord, the songs that have been sang in honor to worship you and to praise you in spirit and in truth, and song, Lord, that has been offered unto your great name. May you bless your people now and help your children and minister to each need. You see the hearts and lives of your children, Lord. I pray for my brothers and sisters, for those that have lost loved ones. May you bless them, Lord, and help them this morning, encourage their hearts. And may you just guide us now. As we look to you, and may you guide my lips that I only say those things that would be pleasing to you. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you, Brother David. I saw the flowers that Brother Bob brought in here this morning, a very beautiful bouquet. And appreciate each one of you this morning, and for the brothers that have lost their mothers, Brother Bob, Brother Eddie, may the Lord bless you this morning. Fill your heart with His grace this time of need. I had some beautiful flowers sent to my house from the church concerning my sister that had passed away, which I wasn't expecting, but I appreciate them. I have a little note here to read here before I start. It says a hayride that will be October 31st, weather permitting. Thank you, Brother David. It's Sister Glenda's. And Llewellyn Road, Salem, Indiana. Please bring side dish that will go with hot dogs or dessert. Lawn chairs, instruments to play and to sing. And then there'll be some sports for people. And this is You may text the following, Chris, Lori, and Brittany. So I'll give that to them to put up back there. So remember that, and pray for Sister Glenda. Mary Lou got up this morning in her port. She's had a port for 8 or 10 years. It was bothering her. Remember her, if you would, this morning concerning this. But it had eased some before I left. So praise the Lord for everything, every little inkling. I just thinking of setting up here, brothers, I just thinking of setting up here. I mean, we're winners. I'm not looking at a bunch of losers. I'm looking at winners, and I know that sometimes we go in leaps and bounds and sometimes in inches. So whatever the Lord wants to do, I just thinking about that. Just when the devil comes after us, he does. Let us realize that it's him. And that he is trying to put things in our mind or something that don't belong there. It's not a part of what you believe or what that you desire. This could be encouragement to some of the young people because because that you have become a Christian, don't feel discouraged concerning the temptations you have to go through, because everybody has to. We're not exempt, but it's just learning how to, and I hate to say it this way, but it's just learning how to handle the devil. That poses a threat to our very belief, because if he can do that, then he feels that he's a winner. I know there are so many people anymore, if you see any on television, they talk about the, it comes from really Revelation 12, which is not a part of my message, but Revelation 12, it talks about there in the 11th verse, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death, and they connect that all together, which is not all together. This is talking about both Jew and Gentile. There where it says, by the blood of the Lamb, and then by the word of their testimony, which is Jews. And you see that in Revelation chapter 6, which I hope to touch on concerning this message, if I'll try to this morning. But there's just a lot in the message that I'm on that sooner or later, I'll have to quit. I realize that. But I said last Sunday that it's an ongoing thing. What I meant was, it's not just something that you can just keep ongoing as far as ministering, but the ongoing thing is that it's something that's going to happen right on down to where the church is gone and then beyond that. That's what I'm talking about, it being ongoing. I wasn't talking about the message that I'll be preaching is just going to be ongoing. But there's so many things that are happening this morning to let us know that this is the time. This is the time for... I never meant to point anything to myself, but this is a time for this message. I believe that it is a time for this message to go forth because we're in that time. we just, the Jews just had their New Year holiday just this last week, which was Yom Kippur. And if you date back to 73, that was when the Jews were attacked by Syria and by Egypt and by other countries that are round about them, that Golie Meir thought that she was, that they were going to lose. But that's not knowing the scripture or not being able to apply it to the hour we're living in. And God is so good to us. He watches over us and He protects us, and He'll protect us from the enemy when the enemy comes in like a flood. He is there to protect us, to stop that flood, which would be persecution. Sometimes I forget that I have water, and I wind up at the end that I'm that I'm depleted. So I'll try to remember that. I know down to see Sister Linda, and Brother Kevin was down there, and then others that are family were down there yesterday, and of course I went in to see her, and she was feeling very good, but she was talking a lot because she's happy, and that is was kind of a bad thing for her, and I might cause part of that myself, but our sister is not completely well. So remember her. She's a good sister, and I told her that she was. I know I tease her some and so on, and she come right back at you. But she's a good woman. She's a good sister, and I told her she was. And the Lord be praised. I want to feel the effects of when somebody else is going through a trial to go through with them. And whenever we get to the point that our brothers and sisters are as important as we are, they used to say that there's three people that more or less knew what they wanted. Me, I, and myself. And I don't want to feel that way. I want to feel a part of something, not to set myself off to the side because I'm some important person. Don't ever get that in your mind. I don't want people to feel that way. Because whenever we get to heaven, which we're expecting to, because the price has been paid, when we get there, we're not going to be big I and little you. And Jesus pointed that out very plainly in John chapter 13 when he washed the disciples' feet. Because he said, "This do in remembrance of me." Really, that was concerning the communion part, but he said that concerning our washing one another's feet. He said, "This is for an example. It's an example for us to follow, that we must do the things that are pleasing to God. So I've got scriptures here that I need to get into. We want to go to this morning to I've got Jeremiah 25 or 24 first. Just one verse there. And then we'll go into 24 or 25. I'm not mixed up, I'm just saying it wrong. Jeremiah 20, no, it's 25, sorry. Verse 4. And the Lord has sent unto you all his servants, the prophets, rising early and sending them, but ye have not hearkened nor inclined your ear to hear. They said, turn ye again now to everyone from his evil way and from the evil of your doing, and dwell in the land that the Lord hath given unto you and to your fathers forever and ever. I mean, even at this late hour, and this is a late hour that he was talking to them. I mean, but God is still pleading. Turn. I believe that he has pleaded with America in time past to tell them to turn from their wicked ways and dwell in the land that the Lord hath given unto you and to your fathers forever and ever. This was a promise. And go not after other gods to serve them and to worship them, and provoke me not to anger with the works of your hands, and I will do you no hurt. Yet ye have not hearkened unto me, saith the Lord, that ye might provoke me to anger with the works of your hand to do your own hurt. Therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, because ye have not hearkened unto my words, behold, I will send and take all the families of the north, saith the Lord, and Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant. Sometimes people may look at it, God's got a very bad choice. Because he is not going to be very good to the Jewish people. But just like Pharaoh, he had a purpose for Nebuchadnezzar. And this was to change their attitude. When people don't change their attitude concerning the things of God, then God is obligated by his word to do something concerning what is going on. This wasn't a week time, a week's time. This goes on for hundreds of years. That they have disobeyed God. So
God, according to what He has already promised, is going to do something about it. He's not going to let it go. And I'm kind of comparing that to this time in America, because America has made herself a part of this that He is speaking here through Jeremiah, and I'll show you that. My servant, and we'll bring them again into this land, and against the inhabitants thereof, and against all those nations round about, and will utterly destroy them, and make them an astonishment, and a hiss, and a perpetual desolations. Moreover, I will take from them the voice of myrrh, and the voice of gladness, and the voice of the bridegroom, and the voice of the bride, the sound of the millstone, and the light of the candle. He's saying what all He's going to do, and it don't leave much after He's done what He said. And this whole land shall be a desolation and an astonishment. That goes to show when Mark Twain went through there. He made it look like it was a place of doom, because there's no roads. It was grown up. It was a wilderness. And the Megiddo Valley, which is so beautiful today, had all kinds of snakes and alligators and everything else in there at one time, because it became a swamp. Until recent years. You read that 11th verse again. And the whole land shall be a desolation and an astonishment, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years. Now this was what I was getting to. 70 years And the reason for that is because they haven't kept His Sabbaths. Because to the Jews, the Sabbath was a time that God wanted them to recognize. It's as it was as much to them to recognize the laws as it is for us to recognize what He has done for us in this days concerning Jesus Christ. I'm not saying that the Sabbath and all of that is important as Jesus Christ, but it was by keeping the law, this was their salvation. And by the Word of God, and our salvation today rests entirely upon Jesus Christ. That was spoken by Jeremiah, because that he had seen this from the hand of God. And that's what it was, because when Daniel in the 10th chapter, when he is looking at it, he's looking at it, this is the 70 years. And it shall come to pass when 70 years are accomplished that I will punish the king of Babylon and that nation, saith the Lord, for their iniquity, and the land of the Chaldeans, and will make it a perpetual desolation. Didn't that is when the Medes and the Persians come in there. Belshazzar, of course, he had his big party. He had all of his lords, all of his concubines, all of his musicians and everything to come in. And that wasn't the big thing. The big thing was whenever he began to get the vessels of the house of God, of which that they had stolen away, and he began to drink his wine out of that, then the handwriting come on the wall. The handwriting is on the wall today concerning America. Look at it. I could say something here, but it probably wouldn't be appropriate. We've got a leadership in this country today that don't know what they're doing. Brother Branham said that there would come a time when Washington would be a place that people would be insane. I'm not talking about putting them someplace in some place, but it's their ideas and their opinions that they are passing on to this country because they're ignoring the proclamations and all of the Constitution that was laid out for this country. They have forgot it, and God is getting ready to punish this country. He already is. Look at the rain. Of course, Brother Bud and them were going to South Africa, and they were to leave Friday, and then they find out that they can't go to Atlanta because of the rain. Had to put it off a day. And I will bring upon that land all my words which I have pronounced against it, even all that is written in this book, which Jeremiah hath prophesied against all the nations. For many nations and great kings shall serve themselves of them also, and I will recompense them according to their deeds and according to the works of their own hands. See, all the time he's talking about Nebuchadnezzar, his servant, then he's pronouncing judgment against the nation because of their punishment of the Jews, of which God pronounced would happen. God don't change his mind. He don't change his word. I want to go to Jeremiah chapter 16. Verse 14. Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that it shall no more be said, the Lord liveth, that brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. He's talking about something that is still future. Of course, this has been an outstanding thing with the Jewish nation, how God brought Israel out of Egypt. They go back to the law. This is what they talk and teach is the first five books of the Bible. Which is called the Septuagint. The Jews, of course, believe their prophets, but this is your Orthodox Jew belief, is the five first books of the Bible and what they go by. But God is going to change that in their minds. See, this is the outcome of what is coming in these latter verses. He speaks the good first. You won't no longer talk about what has happened in the days of Moses. You'll no longer talk about that. Because the Lord is going to do something in the land of Israel to cause them to forget about their past. Here's the answer. But the Lord liveth that brought up the children of Israel from the land of the north and from all lands whither he had driven them. And I will bring them again unto their land. That I gave unto their fathers. It's already a done deal. The deed is already written. The world don't believe it. Get rid of the Jew. We hate the Jew, they say, because they're all the trouble of the Middle East. Get rid of the Jew and then you will have peace. What a lie. They didn't have peace before the Jew went in there. Behold, I will send for many fishers. Saith the Lord, and they shall fish them. See, he got everything lined up, and he uses time according to the scripture in order to fulfill his will. God does things in fours for judgment. What I mean, fours, and if you look at it, fours would be 4 times 7, which is 28. '19 and '17 was when the World War I ended. I got to thinking about this the other day. You go back 28 years. In your 1989, that is exactly the time that God was sending his fishers. Or 1889, I said 19. 18 and 89 is when he had sent his fishers in there in the 80s. on up into the 90s. And he fished for them. He sent rabbis, men that had a message. And their message was telling the Jews, go home. It is time. They went over Europe. They went over Germany, but everything was going good for them, just like it has in the United States. Wall Street is more controlled by Jews than anybody. Streets are named after them. The Rothschilds and men of that caliber. That have controlled the market. I worked with a fella from Springfield, Kentucky. Over at Ford. He was a black man. Always treated me good. Brother Larry back there knows him. His name was Gus Cooper. His mother saw one day this Jew come into town of Lebanon, Kentucky. They lived there at the time. He come in there with a knapsack, a coat, just a knapsack. She said, you watch him. He'll own this city. Thirty, 40 years ago, it was run by him. He was even mayor. God put that in them because he told them they'd prosper. But they couldn't leave their stocks, their bonds, their shops. And they more or less mocked the Jews that were sent to them. Those rabbis that talked to them, trying to get them to go home. We don't need you. We're doing quite well. Then you come to 1917. 28 years later, we've got a war going on in Europe. And I remember Brother Branham saying, it stopped in the autumn of 1917. And I remember Brother Branham saying, they didn't even know why it stopped. Just a treaty that was signed all at once. It just come to a head at once. And then the next year, you had the Balfour Declaration, which gave the Jews a parcel of land. England at the time, they had a saying, we got a flag in every port. And they did. But England, lost. Their stock market fell. Germany, their stock market fell. Here come Hitler. He didn't like it. He wasn't a popular person. His dad beat him when he was a little boy and thought he was dead. And his mother nursed him back to health. But he was a strange little boy. And I mean strange. Because he got a little older and his mother died, and he would go and lay down on the grave and cry. She had four other children, I believe it was. None of them acted like that, but Adolf Hitler. This is a little bit of history, I know that. But then he began to blame the Jews for Germany losing out. And this thing stirred in him and boiled in him, and finally he got a few people to listen to him. And it built, and he began to gain momentum. And then as he does, finally he gets 10,000 people that were backing him. And whenever he did, then he began to take over parts of the government. This didn't awake the Jews. The 30s come. You got the fall of the stock market in 31. A little 29. See a pattern? 14 years later than 1917. God works in numbers. And the stock market crashed. But in 1917, after England had lost all of her prestige, it became America now. I've got a picture here of the lamb beast. Revelation 13, verse 11. A lamb, whenever it's born, don't have horns. Remember that. She's gone on many years. You come to Woodrow Wilson in the teens there. Woodrow Wilson wants a world empire. That's when progressivism started. You know what progressivism is? It is you just keep getting better and better and you're leaving God out of the picture. Because you're pushing for a one world dictator. But that idea was defeated. And he turns out to be one of the worst presidents that there had been up to that time. In 1917, the lamb begins to grow its horns. Because the United States now takes over where England had left off. And she becomes stronger, stronger, and stronger. I'll come back to this again if I've got time. I want to go to Revelation chapter 13. And I beheld another beast come up out of the earth. And he had two horns like a lamb. And he spake as a dragon. It's now the devil. When he begins to speak like that, not when he was that lamb back up to that time, you had your war, you had your conflicts. But it wasn't. Until she began to get prestige and power, especially under Roosevelt. He believed in progressivism. I'm just trying to show you how things have progressed to get us to where we are today. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, which is your two parties. Democrats and Republicans, look at them today. They'd just soon to lie to you as to tell the truth. They sling mud at each other. I saw this sign one time, which I said something the other day. This sign said, when you're slinging mud, you're losing ground. And he exercises all the power of the first beast before him. Look at it. Look at Europe. Look under Rome. He exercised all the power of the first beast. That's where it began, was in Rome.
But America's getting weaker. At one time,
Germany played with America under Roosevelt because he was in his fourth term and each term just got worse. I had a friend in World War II that was captured, made prisoner for 6 months till the war was over. 6'3", weighed 90 pounds when he got out. But he had enough God in him. He went in the army when he was drafted when he was 17, and he was told, you won't go overseas till you're 18. 6 months later, he was in prison, still 17 years of age. Him, his sergeant, and a lieutenant was all that was left out of the rest of them were all killed. And there's some Germans waiting on him. So he goes to the top of this hill to look for them, and he sees them, and he falls down. Whenever he does, his helmet comes off and it rolls down the hill, and they raise up and they begin to fire at his helmet, thinking that was him. And he tucked them out. But at the time that he did, he saw himself walking back down the road home. In a vision. He sees a vision of himself walking back home. He knew then he'd go back home. God done miracles in World War II. We won that. But that's the last war we've ever won. We left Vietnam with them firing at us. Firing at the helicopters and the planes as they were leaving because we lost. And he exercises all the power of the first beast before him and causes the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. What did we do? World War II was over. We built back Europe. We left our troops there. They're still there today to protect them. So they have built back. While we have protected them, they didn't need an army. I remember Jimmy Carter. Ayatollah captured 44 of our people and kept them 400 and some days. Jimmy Carter put an effort to try to rescue them, but it didn't work. Just like World War II, whenever they didn't fear Roosevelt, but this man that I was telling you about was captured and put into prison. He's the one that I said weighed 90 pounds. He's put in prison, and whenever he was put in prison, and then Roosevelt died, then some of the officers that took care of the prison said, "What kind of a man is this Truman?" The Germans, "What kind of man is this Truman? Oh, he's just like Roosevelt." They said, "No, he's not. We're afraid of him." And then they bombed Europe. They bombed the cities. We were in there. When Brother Swain took us, where Hitler was buried, the bunker is still there. We saw the wall that had been torn down. Section of it still there as a representative. What a blessing. When those boys come home, my brother was in Guam, World War II, and when he come home, my dad and mom knew that he was coming home, and he told them a certain time because he's going to fool them. But we had a neighbor said, "No, he'll get in here in the morning about 4 o'clock. And he had said another time. He said he'll be here about 4 o'clock in the morning. So my dad was up waiting. And he heard this car come down the road, and it stopped at a certain place, turned around. And here walked my brother. Come home. I was 8 years old. But I'll never forget my dad shouting, crying. Because we didn't know if we'd ever see our brother again. Dad never knew he'd ever see his son again. This was a great victory for America, but this was the last. Brother Jackson said, "We'll never win another battle." It's been that way since that very time. We've had every opportunity in the last several years to be strong. when 9/11 happened, which was just a few days before Elul 29, which was the 17th of that year. 6 days later, stock market fell. See, God has a plan. He's got a pattern that He's going to work with. And He doeth great wonders, so that He maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. Oh yeah, we've put our men in space. We sent them to the moon. I remember James Irwin when he went there. He became a Christian man. He believed that he would find Noah's Ark because he went on expeditions there and he had a heart attack and died. We brought the atomic bomb down. Two of them. That ended the Japanese part of that war. The Lamb Beast spoke. I want to go back in Revelation to chapter 6. Ninth verse. And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them which were slain for the word of God, Jews. Brother Branham, when he preached the seals, he said, this is those Jews that lost their lives at the Holocaust. Ten years ago, during this time of when that Brother Jackson preached the seals, 16 messages. It was going on at this time. 10 years ago. He brought more into that. He said, and those Jews on back that have lost their lives because so-called Christianity killed them because the Jews killed Jesus. Much has been made of the Crusaders, but the Crusaders acted like devils. Yeah, they thumbs down on the Jews. Just as evil as the Muslim world is today. They killed the Jews back there, but somewhere, as I finish this up here, for the testimony, for the slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held, the same thing that I read to you in Revelation 12. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, "How long, O Lord, holy and true?" See, they believed in God. There they're waiting. No white robes. They were there. They weren't permitted to be in the place of the Gentiles. Not yet. They laid there, some of them, for centuries of time. But they felt a longing. How long? They cried with a loud voice, saying, "How long, O Lord? Holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth?" And white robes were given unto every one of them. See now, they've got white robes. All that were in that number that were crying, "How long?" White robes were given to every one of them, and it was said unto them that they should rest yet a little season. We're in that season. ...1945 was ...28 years... from 1970. White robe were given to every one of them, and it was said unto them that they should rest yet a little season until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. What are these white robes? Go to the 7th chapter. Verse 9. This is the great multitude. After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hand. Praise the Lord. Those Jews are equal. Because the same white robe is given to them that these great multitude have. Isn't God good? To give that opportunity that they had to be able to feel as they felt rejected. Now then they feel accepted. The If you feel that you're rejected this morning, that God has rejected you, don't feel that way. No one is better than the other. If you be 30, 60, or 100, you're all in the same, you're going to all be put in the same chute. Because the thing about it is, the wind's going to blow and blow all that chaff away, and you're going to be nothing but wheat. I appreciate your attendance this morning. I appreciate your listening to me. May the Lord bless you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we're grateful to you for your love for us and your grace you've shown us. And I pray for my brothers and sisters. I pray for the sick. I pray for the suffering. Because of my brothers and sisters that are going through things. Lord, for that long trip to South Africa, that they're still flying. Lord, rest their bodies. Don't let them arrive with pain and problems, Lord, but may they be rested. Now bless your people in other nations, Lord, that are listening, those in South Africa, those in Norway, and other places, Lord, that would be listening, and those that would be on the internet later on, Lord, that it's midnight at some places, especially in Philippines. Bless my brothers and sisters, Lord. Give them comfort of heart. Thank you for all you've done. Thank you for what you're doing. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. May God bless you.
Little flock of mine, would I not speak these words unto thee this morning? As my servant has stood before thee this morning and delivered that of my word, I said, had it not been spoken with tenderness and humbleness and love this morning, has not the hearts of some been pricked that sit here among thee? I say, little ones, if I am pulling and dealing with thee, and I am, for thou dost feel that tug, I say, surrender unto me. For I say unto thee, I would have thee walk before me, tender and humble of heart, with an open mind, that I may speak and deal in that of thy life. I say, it is not the proud and the haughty that I call, but it is the humble and the meek of spirit. This morning I say once again, surrender and submit thyself unto thee, to me, and I say, I will truly move in thy life, saith the Lord.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hey.
Many can say they enjoy that this morning. The Lord is good. Let's go ahead and stand. And if there's anybody that has a need, let the brothers pray for you. You can go ahead and come on.
Oh, peace, peace, wonderful peace, coming down from the Father above. the light from God's lighthouse shine. God's lighthouse shine on me, oh shine on me, oh shine on me. Let the light from God's lighthouse shine on me, oh. God's lighthouse shine on me. The anchor holds, oh, the ship is battered. The anchor holds, the sails are torn. Oh, I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea. But the anchor holds in spite.
Sails are torn. Well, Thankful the anchor holds this morning. Praise the Lord. Appreciate that message this morning, Brother Allen. And we certainly appreciate the Spirit of God and for His presence here this morning. We love Him very much. May the Lord go with you this day and be with you. May we all come back together tonight at 6 o'clock. And let's just pray and ask the Lord to go with us. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank You today. Father, for this time this morning that You've allowed us to come together. Father, Your Spirit and Your presence has been in our midst, Lord, for we have felt it this morning. And Father, Your anointing, God, that rests upon Your servant as He brings forth the Word. We're so thankful this morning for that. For God, You're so mindful of us and so aware of our needs, Lord. We thank You, Lord, for those that came up for prayer today. And we just ask that You would touch them, Lord, and be with them and meet their needs, Lord. Be with every child of God, those that are traveling, Lord, on long journeys. Those in other countries, Lord, our brothers and sisters. We think of them this morning, Lord, and we just ask that You would be with them. Father, we ask that You would go with us throughout this day. Lead and guide us by that of Your Spirit. May You have Your way in our lives, Lord. May we be a light to this world that is darkened, Lord. We ask all of these things in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.